实主任、博士生导师、主任医师。Professor Liu Yan is the professor, doctoral supervisor, chief physician, director of the Obstetric and Gynecological Education Center. 他是我国首位带教的妇科微创手术临床应用及基础研究博士的导师。Dr. Liu Yan is the first doctoral supervisor of clinical application and basic research of minimally invasive gynecology surgery in China. 他也是1990年赴日本大阪市作为客座研究员，1996年赴美国斯坦福大学医疗中心妇产和生殖免疫实验室进行博士后研究，并在其妇科内窥镜培训中心学习。In 1919, Dr. Liu Yan visited a researcher in Osaka City, University of Japan, and in 1996, she studied in the Obstetric and Gynecological Reproductive Immunology Laboratory of Stanford University Medical Center for postdoctoral research and got trained in the Training Center for Gynecological Endoscopy. 他还有很多的很多的学术头衔，那么我今天就不占用时间来介绍。那么我们的第二位就是刘燕教授将会作为我们的讨论嘉宾来加入到我们的会议当中。那么我们第一位讲者的话呢是Dr. Antonio Accardi。Dr. Antonio Accardi, 他是意大利巴勒莫大区公共卫生系统医院的主任Physician of Public Health System Company Hospital。他是意大利的内窥镜学院的宫腔镜手术指导员。He is the faculty for hysteroscopy at the Italian School of Endoscopy. 他的主攻方向呢有妇科肿瘤、子宫内膜异位症、HPV 疾病、妇科内窥镜以及各种宫腔镜的手术。Dr. Antonio specialized in the oncology, gynecology, endometriosis, the HPV disease, and gynecological endoscopy, and especially all the field of hysteroscopy. 那么接下来我们先将时间交给我们的Antonio Doctor, 然后在第二位讲者进行授课之前我再来进行介绍。Okay, welcome Dr. Antonio Accardi. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yeah, very clear.
Okay, I'm sorry. Thank you very much for your kind introduction. It's a pleasure to speak with you and meet you. I want to wait one second. I want to share my presentation and my... Can you see me?
No, I cannot see your
Just
PPT here. On the screen.
Okay, one second, sorry.
Okay, no problem.
Okay, maybe now you can see me?
Yeah, very clearly. I can see you.
Thanks again for your introduction. Nice to meet you. So, one second, I want to share even my presentation. Can you see?
No, now I cannot see your PowerPoint.
Okay. And now, I think you can see my presentation.
No, please share your screen.
I'm sharing. If you see me.
No, at the bottom.
I'm doing it.
Yeah, it's working now.
Yeah.
Now it's working?
Yeah, it's on the screen.
Okay, I'm sorry. Okay, nice, perfect. So thanks again and good morning, everybody. And I just want to thank you for the kind introduction I told before, and thanks to Bones and PMMed for the kind invitation. I confess that I would like to be with you right now in China, but I hope to do in future. And anyway, thanks to technologies, most like I was there. I just hope Only wish you good health for all of us, and I hope we will see the light in some months about this pandemic that now in Italy is coming up again. Anyway, today I'm talking about the state of art of office stenoscopy. So we don't know each other, and my name is Antonio Accardi. I am an Italian gynecologist, just like you. I studied in Palermo in the center of the Mediterranean Sea in Sicily. I attended the most important Italian hysteroscopy school. And after the specialization, I started an oncological gynecologic endoscopy and a special hysteroscopy path. Since 2007, I have been a scientific consultant for hysteroscopy, and basically I love my job and I do it with passion, that I think is the base for to do everything. My passion was transmitted by my father, and so in 2007, I did my first collaboration with the J&J company, with the young Italian hysteroscopy team. In 2011, I started my journey with a German company called RZ, and the first step was to set their hysteroscopy catalog, and the instruments, inserting some news and and presenting the first model of my rotating mechanical hysteroscopy instrument. After a few years, we came out with a top version of mechanical hysteroscopy instrument with some unique features. In 2015, I started my scientific collaboration with the famous Italian company PM Med, and together we started investing in the 18 French mini resectoscope, and after a few years, we came out with our first cold knife. This was followed by the first presentation of the instrument at some World Congress, and we had some small satisfaction and success in the world. The rest is now spread. Today, we are here to talk about hysteroscopy. What is hysteroscopy? Hysteroscopy is a minimally invasive direct technique. Sorry, because there is something in my screen. Hysteroscopy is a minimally invasive endoscopic direct technique able to visualize vagina, cervical channel, uterine cavity, endometrium, and tubal orifices. And directly today we are able to treat their pathologies. I want to remind everyone that our brain is able to interpret images captured in our case from a screen. And I mean that indirect technique means that we have to interpret an image captured, for example, with the ultrasound. And for example, as you can see, this could be an endometrial polyps. But the direct technique means that you, in this case, for example, can see inside the cavity and look if there is something like, in this case, is a polyps. Why we are talking about hysteroscopy? Because hysteroscopy today is the world gold standard for diagnosis and therapy of the intrauterine pathologies. And today, with hysteroscopy, we are able to afford the major part of gynecological pathologies. This is not just my word, but is written in all the literature. Let's see what are the most frequent and important reasons for gynecological examination. If we focus, for example, on infertility, we can find that about 33% of couples suffer from it. If we focus on abnormal uterine bleeding, we know that is the first reason of gynecological consultation. And according to the Palm-Cohen classification, polyps and leiomyomas and malignancies are the most important organic disorder. What do they have in common? They have in common that they need hysteroscopy. So for the reason, imagine how many hysteroscopies are needed in gynecological practice. Let's see now how we can treat this gynecological problem around the world. In all over the world, there are different options. I don't know exactly what you perform, for example, in China, but I know that in somewhere someone uses hysteroscopy, someone diagnostic hysteroscopy, someone resectoscopy, PPL, Babra, office hysteroscopy, and all the rest. It's not easy today classify and divide all the practice in use in the world. We can basically divide the two types of endouterine technique. The technique under direct vision, easy to achieve the goal, and I mean hysteroscopy performed in office or in operation theater. And blind technique, and I mean Pipel, Babra, Novak, and Curette, that I think is almost inadmissible and dangerous, in my opinion, because it's like to shoot an arrow turning on the other side. Then we can try to divide them even in two different settings, the office setting and the operation room setting. In office, we can perform a blind and direct technique. Clearly, direct is the best solution we can have. In particular, office hysteroscopy is the best choice. Consider that in office, usually, we don't need sedation, we don't need blood exam, we have a low complication risk, we have a short observation, less than 30 minutes, we don't have a particular contraindication, and we have a faster recovery after the procedure. In operation theater, usually, we can perform a resectoscopy and even a DNC. The DNC and the resectoscopy always need the ACC, the blood exam, the sedation and the anesthesia, the post-surgery rest, the job they lost, all the high-risk complications, and all the anesthesia complication. I just want to open a short parenthesis of the operation theater procedure, even if we have to talk about something different, because dilatation and curettage is the most widespread gynecological practice in the world. And as I told before, we need anesthesia, blood exam, and all the rest. But in particular, we know that with DNC, we have just a partial tissue sampling, a high recurrence of symptoms, and high persistence of pathologies. With the resectoscopy or mini resectoscopy, we know that is performed still in the operation room, and usually is able to solve the problem in one step. But the really sad notice of today is that still DNC is the most widespread gynecological practice in the world, as I told. To reinforce my speech about that, there are some scientific citations I want to show you, but the most important is the green one, made by Cooper in 1919, in which he told us that hysteroscopy allows for a direct visualization of intrauterine abnormalities in patients with abnormal uterine bleeding, and for specific treatment of the time of diagnosis. To close this parenthesis, at the beginning of the year 2000, fertility and sterility tried to end the discussion in this way. Told us that hysteroscopy has taken the place of the DNC in the gynecological practice. So going back to our setting and closed the parenthesis, now we have to open the door of our office and see what we can do. Today, the best office setting we can offer to the patient and even for the doctor is the hysteroscopy. That could be diagnostic, that is a good solution, but not the best, in which you can just take a look inside the uterine cavity. But the office hysteroscopy with the see and treat philosophy is the best absolute solution you can offer to the patient, because as in this case, you can perform the biopsy of the suspicious mass of the endouterine of this endouterine patient to offer her a fast diagnosis. I want to spend some words about the old, in my opinion, diagnostic hysteroscopy option, because the pure diagnostic hysteroscopy is just like a vintage procedures, like to drive, I think, a vintage car or on a nice highway. Because we just have the possibility to see inside the uterus without any types of operativity. And maybe still today, someone of us used the round hysteroscope with specula, with carbon dioxide, and with tenacum. And I want to focus just on the small number of indications we have for diagnostic hysteroscopy, because we have about 10 indications and without any types of operativity. For our fortune, in 1996, we had the revolution of office hysteroscopy, because decreasing one diameter of the round hysteroscope and give us a new hysteroscope with oval shape, we were able to afford almost all the cervical channel with a major adaptability of the instrument just to the orifice. So we had the introduction of the new office operative hysteroscope, and thanks to the vaginoscopical approach, the small diameter operative hysteroscope, the liquid distension media, the office surgery instrument, and the avoiding of anesthesia or anesthesia, was born the CN-treat office procedure. And I'm talking about 1997, I mean about 30 years later. After about 13 years in the UK, someone's wake up, in particular Dr. Ertan Seridogan, is very famous in Europe, and he tried to compare three different ways to perform hysteroscopy in outpatient setting with the CN-treat service, or in outpatient with the referral service, or in general anesthesia. And the result was very awesome, because he wrote that hysteroscopy, it was the standard for the abnormal uterine bleeding in Europe and in North America for diagnosis and treatment of abnormal uterine bleeding with the CN-treat procedure. But he told us that a survey made in 2002 reported that more than half of gynecologists in the world perform hysteroscopy only under general anesthesia, and about 40% of these perform hysteroscopy as a pure diagnostic procedure. So the news are very impressive. And even when outpatient hysteroscopy is offered, approximately half of gynecologists offered only diagnostic service. That's very important. In 2010, he wrote that about 40% of diagnostic hysteroscopies in the United Kingdom are still performed in the inpatient setting, and that's very important. In the table on your right, I want to show just you that the paper demonstrated that in general anesthesia, it was enormous expenses for the patient and for the health system. Comparing it to the the outpatient CN treat, you can have about 30% of expenses less. Even the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists expressed his opinion about hysteroscopy. And the ideas of the college was, I think, a little bit confused, because in 2013 and 17, they told us to perform the DNC with the assistance of hysteroscopy to manage the acute anormal bleeding. 1 year later, and I mean in 2018, they told us that office hysteroscopy is the best procedure for the patient, with higher patient satisfaction, with faster recovery, especially compared with the office, with the procedure made in anesthesia. So I think that after all the confusion made by this society, we have to divide the endouterine surgery in two categories. The office surgery hysteroscopy made with a wake patient without any type of sedation, with an operative office hysteroscope with five French operative channel, in which we can put inside our mechanical instrument. And for example, as I'm doing in this video, I'm making the lysis of the external uterine orifice with a wake patient. And under direct vision, step to step, we can perform in this way, the lysis of the intrauterine synechia without any particular discomfort for the patient. Because in my opinion, still today in Italy especially, is not convenient to go in the operation room to perform something like that. And we just need the operation room with the mini resectoscopy or resectoscopy just for some operation like a big myoma like this, or uterine septa or endometrial ablation. On your left, as you can see, we are performing an easy polypectomy with mechanical instrument, always with a weight patient. Thanks to the office hysteroscopy, we are faced by about 10 indications for diagnostic hysteroscopy, to about 30 and more indication for the set office setting. I mean that now with office hysteroscopy, you can, I don't know, recover the lost IUD inside the uterine cavity without any particular sedation or anesthesia. You can perform some polypectomy in a Virgo patient. You can perform a fast diagnosis of endometrial cancer. But you can even, as our colleague explained us in the next presentation, overcome the limitation of office hysteroscopy and treat something really new and in particular, like the tubal ostium polyps, the expulsion myoma, the opium technique, the Virgo patient, the patient who wants to stay awake, the high-risk anesthesiological patient, the patient with the huge vagina, the patient with a particular disability, and the patient with oversized BMI like mine, because especially in Italy, we have, and in Southern Italy, we have a lot of patients affected by obesity. To do that, naturally, we need not just the office hysteroscope, but a lot of instrument. I mean mechanical instrument and electric instruments. We have to put them inside our office operative hysteroscope that usually is about 5.5 millimeters, and it have an operative channel of 5 French in which you can put all the instrument I told now. In particular, we have a lot of mechanical instrument. We are basically two types, scissor and forceps, with the various functions that I will show in the next slides. They have different shapes and different lengths. Along with these, there are also the special instruments like the shark, like the harpoon, like the denacum. And I want to show you that just in 2004, we had the first publication about operative hysteroscopy made just with a mechanical instrument. Because thanks to this instrument, we can make something that was impossible before possible today. For example, my favorite is the sharpened scissor, because with the sharpened scissor, as you can see, you can cut the base of the polyp just turning a little bit our scissor. Or for example, as I showed before, you can cut the adhesion inside the cervical channel and proceed step to step inside the cavity. With the grasping, for example, you can perform some polypectomy directly with a wake patient, maybe until 1 centimeter on or something more, you can directly remove it in one step, or you can even gently open the cervical channel to access inside the uterine cavity to see what is inside. And another important instrument and is the electric micro instruments. And here we have to open a little parenthesis on the electrosurgery, because we need the distension media, a liquid distension media. we need an electrolytic or non-electrolytic distension media. It depends if we work with monopolar or bipolar electricity. In my opinion, the monopolar electricity have never worked in office hysteroscopy because is unthinkable today put the table over the patient awake and make something operative. With bipolar, you don't need any table, so I think it's the best solution you can offer to the patient. And in 2002, it was the first publication, I mean about 20 years ago, about surgery made with electric micro instruments in operation, in sorry, in office setting. Considering that there was any new, any particular innovation, still today I tried the plasma in office with a weak patient, and thanks to the particular generator of the plasma able to realize ablation and coagulation in the same time, we don't have any particular carbonization effect. We have less discomfort for the patient and low bleeding. So this is my first operation with the plasma technologies, and I'm sorry because it's not so clear, but I can assure you that it's very, very effective. The electrode could be can be inserted in the operative channel without any problem, and the operation always are fast and with some with a little discomfort. Thanks to all, I think that today hysteroscopy is a technique for all. I mean, all the women in any condition, because we are able to perform hysteroscopy in office. To Virgo patient or to a normal patient or to obese patient, and maybe for all the doctors in any condition. I think that today hysteroscopy is an opportunity for all the doctor and all the patient because it's an easy technique, is a low cost technique, and is a tailored technique for the patient because it could represent the basis for the doctor to build the right therapy for our patient, because hysteroscopy allows us to find the best solution and the best therapeutic strategy with medical therapy, with medical IUD, with resectoscopy, or with the major surgery. Hysteroscopy, in my opinion, gives doctors the opportunity to choose the best therapy for the patient. But are we sure hysteroscopy today is the best solution for all the doctors? I'm not so sure, because about 5 years ago in the ESGE Congress in Budapest, and I mean the most important European of gynecological endoscopy Congress of Europe, one colleague of us told us that about less than 10% of gynecologists perform hysteroscopy or resectoscopy, and all of the other colleagues perform the DNC. So it was a big problem, and now I tried to extract some percentage and some statistics from this discussion, and I discovered that about 20% of us perform diagnostic hysteroscopy and office hysteroscopy, but office hysteroscopy, that is the best solution, is just for 5% of us. All the rest of us perform the operation room procedures, and 60% perform dilatation and curettage, and about 20% just perform resectoscopy. So I think that we have to reverse this percentage, but the problem is that in 2021, someone invent new instrument to perform endometrial biopsy in anesthesia, in outpatient setting. But I think that just in 10 seconds, as you can see, we are able with office hysteroscopy to perform an endometrial biopsy. So we have to reverse this percentage. And to reverse this percentage, I want to show how we have to base on hysteroscopy power. because hysteroscopy power is unstoppable, I think. And with the great spectacle of the treatment of the uterine malformation, I want to show that in the 70s, we used the knife and laparotomy to treat the uterine septa. Later, thanks to technology, we used a resectoscopy to treat the uterine septa. Then in 2007, thanks to the office hysteroscopy and to the diagnostic criteria of the uterine septa diagnosis, we are able to treat uterine septa in the office setting. Sorry. So in the uterine, in 2007, we were able to start a revolution of the uterine malformation treatment, because just with an easy technique, with a simple scissor of 5 French, we are able to treat with a low discomfort for the patient this type of uterine septa according to the actual ESRE guidelines about the uterine septa treatment. After some year, we were able to treat the uterine septa in office with a bipolar technique. And I mean that even with low discomfort for the patient, we are able to treat awake the uterine malformation like the uterine septa. And as you can see, no particular bleeding or no particular uterine contraction during the operation. And maybe in the last years, someone of us are trying to make the uterine septa treatment with the laser. The laser is a new technique. We are making some study, but in my opinion, the plasma technique is really the future, because there is no particular bubble that, as you can see with the laser you have, and even with the bipolar. So, and now I closed my presentation. This is my last slides. I want to show you and exploit the Rogers curve for innovations and adoption life cycle, because I think that today for hysteroscopy in all over the world, not just in Italy, we are here. I mean, in the early adapters parts of the curve, of the course. But I think that there is something more important in my presentation, that is that we have to remember that as our colleagues Philippe Bozzini from France told us in the 18th century, the surgery will not only develop new and previously impossible procedures, but all the certain operations which depend on luck and approximation will become safe under the influence of direct visions, since the surgeon's hands will now be guided by his eyes. This is to close my presentation, that was short, but I hope interesting, because we have to change our mind and use the direct vision of hysteroscopy to offer the patient the best solution still now is proposing all the guidelines. Thank you very much, and I wait for you in Italy and in Sicily, especially soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Ancardi. Maybe several years ago, most of the gynecologic doctor focused on the gynecologic tumor or the laparoscopic surgery, but now more and more gynecologic doctors pay their more attention on the hysteroscopic surgery, because now we have the common sense that the hysteroscopic surgery is the golden standard to make the diagnosis and treatment for the intrauterine cavity disease. Yeah. And in China, we have an old saying that 工欲善其事,必先利其器. What that means? It means that we must have a very good weapon to do the good work. Yeah. Maybe. And Dr. Cardi made a summary about the development of the instrument of the hysteroscopic surgery. Yeah, that made the most development of the hysteroscopic surgery. Yeah, and he emphasized the importance of the vaginal endoscopy. Yeah, because that has so many advantages. He also sharing her operation video to show his excellent operation skills. Thank you very much. Let me share some time. Laterally, we have some discussion time. Okay. Now, next, let me welcome our another speaker, Dr. Stefano Calodelli. Yeah. Stefano 医生呢是意大利佛罗伦萨宫腔镜内窥镜医院的皮罗帕利医院的科学协调官。 He's the scientific coordinator of educational school of endoscopic hysteroscopy at Pallogi Hospital of Florence. 他有超过7000例的妇科内窥镜的一个手术经验。 Dr. Stefano had more than 7,000 cases of the gynecological endoscopy. 他也多次在国际的国家级别的大会当中担任一个主持人和主讲人，组织过多届的国际国家级别的宫腔镜的内窥镜培训班。 And he had been the principal speaker, moderator, and experienced operator in several congresses and international courses of the hysteroscopic endoscopy. 那么接下来我们就将时间交给 Stefano Calori 医生给我们带来的讲题. Now let's welcome Dr. Stefano Calori.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Can I go? This is a okay, dear colleagues and friends, I am honored for the invitation to this webinar. Today, I will introduce a new surgical technique which optimizes and makes more efficient the office of hysteroscopy. This is a standing cervicoplastic surgery. What is? Okay. This is our work, which allows us to overcome the limits of office hysteroscopy. You are able to read, if you want, this work on the scientific journal Gynecologic Surgery. From evolution of hysteroscopic technique, what I have you just seen, begin from 1980 to today, hysteroscopy has greatly progressed. Since 1990, office hysteroscopy has also become operative. So diagnostic hysteroscopy and surgical hysteroscopy no more insuperable obstacle, as in the new technology as a bridge is like a bridge. So the operative office hysteroscopy allows a smooth and progressive transition to surgical hysteroscopy. So hysteroscopy is calibrated according to the instruments and the patient's pathology. This is very, very important. And so our mission is a tailored surgery. It's very important, a tailored surgery. Why? Because office hysteroscopy has a goal point, frame, treat, and solve endocavitary pathology without over-treatment, with customized choice and correct instruments. Limitation, but it's possible to overcome limitation of office hysteroscopy. Yes, but how? With extending cervicoplastic surgery. Extending cervicoplastic surgery is an alternative technique to overcome the limitation of office hysteroscopy. And what is extending cervicoplastic surgery? In which way It allows us to overcome the limits. It is a surgical technique in office hysteroscopy, office, that uses the plasma cinetic unit and the bind scalpel plasma cinetic to increase the size of the cervical ischemic tract by 3 to 6 millimeters each side. But which are the previous limits of office hysteroscopy? First and more important limit in office hysteroscopy is endocavitary neoformations incompatible with diameter of cervical canal. Also, stenosis of the cervical canal, so pap test unsatisfactory, incomplete colposcopy, recurrent hematometra and mucometra, and infertility, no pathogen for the transfer. So we have to overcome limitation of office hysteroscopy. The presence of endocavitary neoformation bigger than 10 millimeters makes the operator's role and his experience crucial. But there is more. Be attention, please. The difficulty of operating in office hysteroscopy is not just linked to the size of the neoformation, but also the complacency of the cervical canal. And so the real cutoff between outpatient inpatient is not the ability to remove the neoformation, but this is very important, but to take it out of the uterine cavity quickly and without discomfort. Clinical reality, what do you think about? Will it go through? Possible, impossible, perhaps possible. Until now, the only solution was parcelization, but is no good solution. Why? Our mission is to avoid the cutoff a lot of section of the neoformation. Why? The side effects of parcelization. Which side effects? Excessive parcelization, so less complete histological response due to thermal damage. And is very important, considerably longer time of the surgery. So scientific feedback of this technique, surgical anatomy. Uterine vascularization, the most important vascularization is from ovarian artery and uterine artery. But the vascularization at the cervical ischemic level is represented by small caliber arterial vessels with consequent small flow of blood. Therefore, the coagulative effect of the plasma cinetic scalpel is enough to eliminate any significant blood loss. Innervation. The uterus is innervated by autonomic system. At the cervical level, the sympathetic, sympathetic and parasympathetic nerve deriva from paracervical ganglia. And then this is very important. This work, Italian work, shows as the neurological studies demonstrate the reduced algogenicity of office hysteroscopy with C and treat surgery is due to sensitive fiber C. What are fiber sensitive fiber C? Are fibers unmyelinated and of small caliber, so slow pain transmission. But there is more. Consequently, we can also go further. In fact, it's not the discomfort that makes the surgery unacceptable for the patient, but it's very important, but its duration, despite the local anesthesia, speaking with patient during the intervention. Muscle and connective fibers. Take two different paths. Why? the amount of muscle fibers decreases from 29% in the internal uterine orifice to 6% at the external uterine orifice. Connective fibers, on the opposite, increase. So, no damage for muscle fibers. Contiguous organ and safety margin is very important. The relationship between cervix, ureter, and the uterine artery can be variable, but the crossing generally is located 15 millimeter lateral to the margin of isthmus and 10 millimeter above the lateral fornix of vagina, so completely safe. But also lateral uterine thickness 40-50 millimeter. Contiguous organ, bladder, anterior, rectum, posterior, and so this is way lateral incision, complete safety. Surgical technique, outpatient with minimally invasive resection of hysteroscopy system, plasma cinetic system, surgery, and which way? Lateral incision by 3 millimeters. How deep the incisions must be? 3 millimeters. This is because the length of the surgical tip is 3 millimeters. This is a good meter. It's very important, all in one step. No curvature of the tip because higher fluidity of the surgical act is very, very important. All in one step. So you can see the intervent. It is necessary, okay? It's necessary to make 2 lateral incisions. You can see the surgical technique, and I repeat, all in one step. So fluidity, and always 3 millimeters deep. It's possible, if it's necessary, to repeat another time to enlarge all cervical canal. So you can see 2 cases with polypoid neoformation and stenosis of cervical canal treated with plasma cinetic surgery and extending cervicoplastic surgery. The first case is a polyp and is a polypectomy in block with only 1 incision at the base of the neoformation, and then extending cervicoplastic surgery. The second case, neoformation bigger, polypectomy with only 1 parcelization. And then you can see and then extending cervicoplastic surgery. It's possible to take polyps out with mechanics instruments easily, quickly, without difficulty, and without discomfort, and without blood, without blood flow. The image is very clear. The polyps take it away simply. And you can see the extending cervicoplastic surgery. So is our goal. After 30 days, no damage. And with a new technique, the hysteroscopy, office hysteroscopy, overcomes the limitation and can reduce intervention in surgical hysteroscopy. È una virtual circus, because extended cervicoplastic expand operation office hysteroscopy, reduce time of intervention, is very important for discomfort, and reduce tissue imbibition, reduce the algogenicity. The solution of for every problem? Yes, all of this involve a new organization, reduce the time and waiting list, regulates the surgery without over or under treatment, optimize the use of health structure. Reducing is very important, reducing the cost. So is a like perfect balancing evolution hysteroscopy can optimize clinical surgery with technique. Clinical surgery technique. Thanks for your attention. If there's a minute more, I would turn it over to Dr. Comito, collaborator of our formation school of hysteroscopy, hysteroscopic endoscopy, and she will show and comment three short but in my opinion interesting videos about office hysteroscopy before the final discussion. Thanks again for your attention.
Hi everybody, I am Chiara Comito and I collaborate with Dr. Calzolari and the School of Hysteroscopy in Florence. We want to show you...
Non si vede il video?
Yeah, I'm going to share this one.
No, ma è anche la senza videocamera, credo.
Ah. Non vedo più. La videocamera. You see the screen?
Yeah.
That I think that is more important than me. Okay. So this is a severe Usherman syndrome. In fact, you can show as when we introduce the hysteroscope, we see in the cervical canal as a wall in the first part. And now Dr. Calzolari, that is the operator of this hysteroscopy, decided to use the scissors to open this wall, and always he use this kind of scissor that is a pointed scissor, not blunt tip. This is why he's a very experienced operator, that you know that without blunt tip is more dangerous for someone use this kind of scissors, but the cut is very perfect, as you can see in the video. And with the scissors, it can go through the cervical canal. And it's very important to underline as this kind of office hysteroscopy is performed without ultrasound guided. You see always the wall in the cervix. And the use of scissors is very helpful to overcome this kind of syndrome. And now we are near the uterine cavity. Exactly. So with the hysteroscope, we go through the isthmus and go inside. And inside the uterine cavity, we can see also a flat polyp of the anterior wall. And now, as usual, we show you the spectra B vision. That is very important to see better the vascularization of neoformation that in this polyp is a normal. And now, always with a mechanical instrument, with the scissors, they decide to remove the neoformation. And it's very important how he performed the cut of the base of the polyp. It's a cut in action, not static. And now always with mechanical instruments, so with the grasp. He removed the neoformation and with the work that we did before with the cervical canal, now it is potentially with the remove of the polyp. Okay, after the grasping of the polyp, we can remove, in this case, without cervicoplastic surgery. Grasping of the polyp, we can remove. And now we want to show you a case of a bronchway that was performed during DNC. The patient doing the DNC after a miscarriage. And so again, in the cervical canal, there is a stenosis that this time it was decided to go through the cervical canal with the tip of the hysteroscope, so without mechanical instruments. Perfect, and we arrive very quickly in the uterine cavity. That is a normal uterine cavity. But when we go out, we see perfectly the wrong ray that was performed some month before. Now you can see. Okay, this is the way. And now in the sharp polypectomy, we want to show you these mechanical instrument that was cited also by Dr. Accardi. Now we perform the polypectomy with the plasma cinetic surgery with a spring, always at the base of the polyp to remove it unblocked. And in this case, the polyp was grasped with this particular kind that has some teeth, as you can see in the image, that feel the grasp very hard. and he take the polyp so easily to remove without pasteurization. And perfect, it go out in through the cervical canal. Exactly. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Chiari Comito.
Yeah.
Okay, let me spend a little time to introduce you. She's the medical officer of the first grade level specialized in gynecology and obstetrics at the Territorial Healthcare Faculty of Brenna. 她也是佛罗伦萨宫腔镜的内窥镜教学医院的一个教员。 She's also the partner of the Educational School of Endoscopic Hysteroscopy at Palagi Hospital of Florence. Thank you for your excellent operation video sharing. Yeah. Now let's go to the discussion time. Let's welcome Dr. Liu Yan. 刘教授在吗? 刘教授? 您的那个话筒还没有开? Please open. Yeah. Dr. Liu Yan, 我之前已经介绍过了，是来自复旦大学附属华山医院的我们的博士生导师、主任医师、妇产科教研室的主任啊。Dr. Liu Yan, Professor Liu is the doctoral supervisor and chief physician of the Gynecology and Obstetric Education Center in Huashan Hospital of Fudan University. Okay, now let's welcome Dr. Liu to make her comment on the hysteroscopy. Thank you.
thank you so much. Thank you. So the good presentation, excellent presentation from Italian three professor. I think office surgery, just like the day surgery, laparoscopy day surgery. So it's very important, very good for the patient, especially in the pandemic now. I think we can discuss a lot of things. So allow me to speak a little bit in Chinese to my colleague. Okay?
Yeah. Of course. Yes, since our audience come from all over the world, including the Chinese doctor and the doctor overseas, yeah. 那么刘教授呢，他想用中文来跟大家来讲一下他的这些想法和一些对宫腔镜的一些认识。那么刘教授有请，哎，你啊，不好意思，我看有几十个我们中国同事在这个线上，这个讲。
minimally invasive， 就是我们讲 mini 手术，就是对腹腔镜来讲呢，就是我们强调的是一个越小的切口。现在都是单孔，但是单孔呢，个人觉得还不如 mini， 就是这种3毫米的。那么在宫腔镜下边，特别是宫腔镜下面，所以我们是依赖于这种 good instrument。 It's a good skill. 所以他们这三个教授真的是有这个 good instrument and good skill, good technique. 对我们来讲都是非常非常重要的，因为宫腔就是这么小嘛，所以我们终于期待哈有这样的一个手术器械，真的是不错。我们做腹腔镜做的多，宫腔镜呢，因为就是没有这么好的一个设备。 这么好的一个器械，所以现在大家都比较害怕这种单极电凝啊，或者是还要需要扩张宫颈啊。它这个呢就特别好，很细啊，也不用麻醉，也不用这个叫什么，病人基本上是不痛的。我们现在还仅限于检查的比较多，所以呢特别谢谢他们来介绍这两个技术。特别是在我们新冠流行期间，我们当时在上海做了非常多的 day surgery， 就是 腹腔镜手术 day surgery， 宫腔镜手术呢反倒是，这个没有这么好的东西呢，就需要麻醉，一需要麻醉以后，很多这个医院里边呢，不能给你像做胃肠镜一样到你门诊来去做这种麻醉，所以我们非常非常期待哈这样的好的器械。So I look forward to have the good instrument and the good technique and good skill. So we have to learn from Italian specialist. 所以我们真的是那个非常感谢这次会议啊，请大家多提提问题吧。谢谢我们刘教授啊。
Professor Liu emphasized the importance of the operation instrument. Yeah. Just like I say the Chinese old game, 工欲善其事,必先利其器,没有一个好武器,你怎么来干活呢,是吧? So with the development of the instrument, we can make our power more, make our skill more powerful, yeah. 那么, 其实我刚才看到各位教授的一些手术演示啊, 他们用了一些冷刀, 也用了一些冷量器械, 不知道, 这三位教授关于这个, 保护女性生育力方面，他们会更加侧重于哪些方面？ Just like I said that now the population of the infertile women are become more and more. So, just like the video show, you use the cold knife, and you also use the electric instrument. So, what's your opinion about the different instrument to protect the endometrium? Of the uterus cavity to protect the ability of the being pregnant. Yeah. 刘教授，不知道您在这方面有什么自己的看法吗？
I think the, if you have the plasma, the bipolar plasma instrument, I think it's a bit easier to protect the endometrium. Right?
Yeah. Yeah. And Dr. Akadi, I would like to know what your opinion about which kind of instrument you would choose to protect the endometrium. I mean, the cold knife or the electric instrument. Because some
my favorite instruments are my hands. I protect the endometrium by my hands. So you need a nice skill to perform a nice hysteroscopy. To save endometrium, you need to be really, you need to be really precisious in the operation. So you can perform some cold knife operation just when you have some myoma inside the uterine wall. Usually we perform electricity operation even with awake patient, as I told, but not particular damage we have. Even if, as I told, you need high skill to use this particular instrument. I think that not all the gynecologists can use the plasma, for example, for the first time in office setting, naturally. If you work in operation room with the resectoscope and maybe with a new plasma resectoscope, it's possible to use it. And the damage is less maybe than the bipolar or the monopolar, surely. Even if we need a lot of study to demonstrate it, because still now not study about the plasma with the resectoscope. Maybe we can try to do something together in future.
Yeah, thank you. And this afternoon, Professor Feng Limin, a very famous gynecologic doctor who specialized on the hysteroscopic, he mentioned that in the European country or in America, the daily office hysteroscopy is very popular. I mean that no anesthesia, the patient just do the vaginal endoscopic surgery. Yeah, maybe after operation they just go home. But in China now, most of people are be done the operation under the venous anesthesia. So, what's your experience to sharing? Because the sole population of the uterine cavity disease. Yeah, we just want to reduce the cost of the operation, reduce the daytime in hospital. Yeah. 我想把冯立明拉进来，他说没有打开。今天下午刚刚和冯立明教授在一个会场，他就提到了这个日间宫腔镜和阴道内镜的这个概念啊。我们国内的话，目前阴道内镜的这个概念可能普及的还不是太够，但是刚才看这三位教授的演示，估计在国外这个阴道内镜已经做的是非常的成熟了啊。刘教授您说呢？
对，但是美国好像比较少一点，欧洲比较多一点，欧洲我主要可能还是限于这个手术器械的事情嘛，可能还是这样的，因为欧洲之前出现那个09年那次会，就是这种冷刀的悬切器嘛，是他们那边生产出来，就非常对我们国家非常有用，现在太多太多的这个不孕症病人都是由于这个
我们的这个手术做坏了，没有办法，他们到现在没办法解决，很期待，很期待。是的，意大利转单。我想，随着因为我们国家的这个庞大的这个病人的数量啊，这个宫腔疾病导致不孕的患者也是非常的多。那么，这个阴道内镜提出，还有这个日间宫腔镜的普及，相信能够对我们国家整体的这个医疗负担、医疗费用的控制，还是大大的有益处的。
您说呢？他们可能对，there is a different medical system in China. So the office surgery, in China means, almost just like day surgery. 就是我们现在医院里边，我们因为都是公立的嘛，他们的 office 呢都是私人诊所比较多。 完了以后特别多，完我们这边就受限制，但是呢，但是实际上在我们公立医院还是可以做到的，因为宫腔镜，就像有这么好的器械，又不要扩宫，也不痛，当然应该是多多推广了，就很可惜啊，就是特别是说，不要扩音器的，就用这个，就刚才我们看到的那么肥胖的病人，直接看到特别好，我们是用小儿的用的比较多。 小儿嘛，他就是用的细的比较，因为成人基本上都是用扩音器，所以病人还是很痛苦的，就是。对对对。我们接受的不光是好的器械，还有介绍他们的 idea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Leo just said that we would like to accept the new concept about the new idea, the vaginal endoscopy, because which can reduce the pain of the patient. And thank you for our three excellent speakers sharing your new the new instrument and your excellent operation skills and your ideas of the endoscopic to our Chinese gynecology doctor. And I think tonight it's a very wonderful webinar. I'm informed that more than 700 audience are on the website to watch the whole speech. Thank you very much. I think most of the gynecology must gain what they have learned. Yeah. 那么到目前为止的话呢，现场已经有超过 700人在线在学习我们今天晚上的这个会议，相信。 在学习的每一位妇科医生一定是有所收获的，感谢我们三位讲者，也感谢我们刘教授的一个经验的分享。那么今天的会议就到此结束。 Thank you everyone. Have a good night. Thank you. Have a good weekend.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Dr. Agadi has some ideas to share further. Hi, Dr. Agadi.
Yes. No, I just want to say something about the office hysteroscopy still now, even is not so popular in China, could be a nice solution for the coronavirus disease, because with the office, you don't need any sedation, so any anesthesiologic procedures and any hospital stay. So for the patient, in 30 minutes, you can solve the problem and avoid any stay in the hospital. In Italy, we are trying to do even to increase this practice just for the coronavirus disease.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
You're welcome.
那么我相信在未来的我们中国妇科医生的努力之下，那么这种将这种理念，就是阴道内镜式的这种宫腔镜无需破宫又给患者带来很少的痛苦的这种理念，肯定会普及到越来越多的越来越广。谢谢。就而且现在在疫情之下的话。 像意大利在疫情期间，他这个手术就推广的非常好，因为在这个手术，他30分钟半个小时解决了一个手术，不用住院。所以在疫情期间，因为医院是没办法收治病人的，所以他们目前这种 office hysteroscopy 就推广的特别好，就大家都还是做这个手术比较多，特别适合现在疫情下这种手术。
我们也谢谢邦氏医疗今天提供这么一个好平台，让我们进行了一个国内国外的一个学术的一个交流，非常感谢。
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Maybe after pandemic, the Chinese doctors, the welcome to the professor from Italy to the China.
Yeah.
After pandemic.
Yeah, we hope the pandemic come over.
Okay. Yeah, we will come.
那今天的会议就到此结束。
Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Bye.
Finish. Bye bye. Thank you. Bye
bye.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Siamo solo italiani.
Hello. Yes, thank you. Today, yeah, we broadcast in Chinese internet. I check. Now we have closed the online. Till now there are 754 audience on the internet. I think this is just a beginning between our communications. China and Italy surgeons communication. And I hope our next webinar would have more audience and we can share more topics.
Okay.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Akadi.
Thank you.
And, thank you, Professor Liu, and thank you, Dr. Stefano Calozzari, and thank you, Chiara Comito. I'm sorry, it's a little bit difficult for me.
Thank you. Welcome to Shanghai. Welcome to China.
Yeah.
In future, after pandemic.
We all.
Yes, thank you. Bye. Yeah, Professor Liu, the first surgeon in China to do the laparoscopy. So in China, we know in gynecology, there is a hysteroscopy and a laparoscopy. Professor Liu is the first in China to do the laparoscopy.
And welcome to Hunan province.
The hysterectomy. Yeah, yes.
Yeah.
And I come from Hunan province, the hometown of Chairman Mao. Welcome to Hunan province.
That's right.
China.
Yes, this is my hometown.
Thank you. Okay, also thank you, Moro. Thank you, Andrea.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Moro.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye bye. See you.
Thank you. Bye.
See you next time.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.
Thank you. Thanks for your time during the weekend. And we hope that we can meet again in our next webinar.
I hope so.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, bye. Enjoy the weekend.
Thank you. You too.
Bye.
Yeah, bye. Bye.
Siamo solo più o meno noi. Mi sente qualcuno?